You're listening to BostonFreeRadio.com.
Hello, listeners out there in Radio Land. I tried to make that more clever. I kind of got tripped up. But anyway, you are listening to the show Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. And usually when I do this show, I have movies I'm going to review. Well, I don't have movies to review for this show, at least not feature-length films. I saw three of them this weekend, but they're going to have to wait until 2 weeks from now, or you're going to have to wait until 2 weeks from now for me to review them. But for now, I'm going to actually review in detail the nominees for Best Documentary Short Subject, Best Live-Action Short Film, and last but not least, Best Short Animated Film. In addition to that, at the end of the show, I'm going to give you my Oscar picks. Sort of a combination of who I think should win and who I think will win, and I will tell you the difference between the two. First, of course, is going to be what's topping the box office. These are the top 10 highest-grossing films of the week. I used to call them box office winners, but the movies that are in the top 10 are not necessarily winners. Sometimes they're lucky enough to reach the top 10, but there have been top 10 films that have bombed as well. But I don't think any of them in this list have actually bombed. But I'll get more into detail about that in a minute. First, though, number one at the box office for the second week in a row, as I predicted last week, the Lego Batman movie. Now, remember, this is a movie to which I gave my rating of a knockout, which is the highest rating I give a movie. So the Lego Batman movie made $42.5 million this weekend. Against a budget of $80 million, the Lego Batman movie has made so far in the United States $107.1 million, and around the world so far it has made $179.2 million, making it a tentative hit both here in the States and around the world, not overseas. Yeah, the international gross includes the United States gross, but the Lego Batman movie is very, very, actually, sorry, I did my math wrong. Here in the United States, it's a tentative hit. Around the world, it is already a certified hit. So good for the Lego Batman movie. And I wouldn't be surprised to see the Lego Batman movie become a certified hit here in the States in the next week, if not the next 2 weeks. 50 Shades Darker is number two at the box office this weekend, as it was last week. Apparently, people didn't heed my warning when I said this movie was a strikeout, which isn't the lowest rating on my scale, but it's the next to lowest rating. So, in other words, it's not worth watching, at least in my opinion. But 50 Shades Darker this weekend made $23.3 million. Against a budget of $55 million, 50 Shades Darker has so far made $92 million just here in the States and a whopping $279.2 million around the world in just 2 weeks. So 50 Shades Darker is coming very close to becoming a certified hit here in the States. Right now, it's just a tentative hit. Around the world, it's already certified with a bullet. The Great Wall is the highest grossing debut movie of the week, but it's also the third highest grossing movie of the week. So The Great Wall earned just $21.7 million this weekend, against a budget of $150 million. Let me say that again. $21.7 million in the United States against a budget of $150 million. So you'd think the Great Wall would be struggling, and it is in the United States. Around the world, though, in just one weekend, it has grossed $262.7 million, which makes it not a hit yet here in the States, but around the world, it's already a tentative hit. And that's actually quite impressive that around the world, The Great Wall has made almost as much money in 1 week as it took 50 Shades Darker to make in 2 weeks. That's pretty incredible. John Wick Chapter 2 was number three at the box office last weekend. This weekend it's number four, having made $19.1 million. Against a budget of $40 million, John Wick Chapter 2 has so far made $61.3 million here in the States and $93.1 million around the world. So, John Wick Chapter 2 is also off to a really good start. Here in the United States, it's a tentative hit. Around the world, it is
a certified hit already. That's pretty impressive. So undoubtedly, there will probably be a John Wick Chapter 3. It's very close to being a certified hit here in the States, and my guess is that it probably will be in 2 weeks. Fist Fight is the number 2 highest grossing debut movie of the week, but the number 5 highest grossing movie overall in the top 10. Fist Fight has this weekend grossed a pretty decent $14.5 million against a budget of $25 million, though. So it's not a hit yet, but it might be by next week. But around the world, Fist Fight has made $16 million. Compare that to just in the United States, it's made $14.5 million, which means in every other country besides the United States, it's only made $1.5 million. But still enough to be close to a tentative hit, but not there yet. Hidden Figures was number 5 at the box office last week. This weekend it slid just a little bit to number 6, but it made $8.7 million this week. And I'll just tell you, here in the States and around the world, it's a certified hit. Here's why. Against a budget of $25 million, Hidden Figures has made so far in the United States $144.2 million, and around the world it has made $165.5 million. So no need to worry about that movie, and it may even make more after or during this next weekend, which is Oscar weekend. Split is number 7 at the box office this weekend, having grossed $8.3 million. Against a modest budget of $10 million, Split has made $124.9 million here in the States and $194.4 million around the world, which means it's a certified hit in both instances. A Dog's Purpose is number 8 at the box office this weekend, having grossed $7.4 million. Against a budget of $22 million, A Dog's Purpose has made $52.5 million here in the States and $66.5 million around the world, which also makes it a tentative hit here at home and around the world. La La Land is going to do gangbusters this weekend, I bet. It's number 9 at the box office, sliding slightly from number 8, but it made $5.4 million this weekend. Against a budget of $30 million, it has made $134.4 million here in the States and $340.5 million around the world, making it a certified hit in both cases. And finally, Lion, number 10 at the box office this weekend, making $5.2 million against a budget of $12 million, it has so far in the States made $37.4 million, just in the States.
It's me, your heart. High blood pressure is serious, and if you think I'm just gonna keep ticking away, you're wrong. I can quit whenever I want, but I like my job. Just treat me better. Maybe we can do some exercise on occasion? After all, we're in...
Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you are either listening on Boston Free Radio or you're watching on SCAT-V or on Facebook Live. I've got two channels going on Facebook Live, my own personal page and Boston Free Radio. Either way, I'm glad you could join me to discuss movies. So as I said in the beginning of this show, this is usually the part where I get into the movies of the week and which ones I've seen, which ones I've recommended and so far, and so on. So this weekend, or rather this show, I'm going to do something a little different. I've seen almost all of the short films that are nominated for Oscars, and I'm going to review all of them for you right now. So for this segment, before the break, I'm going to give you my take on the best documentaries in the short subject category. These are documentaries that are 45 minutes or less that have been nominated for Oscars. And so just to give you a rundown on the nominees for Best Documentary Short Subject are Extremis, which is from the United States, 4.1 Miles, which is from Greece, I think it is, or maybe, yeah, Joe's Violin, which is from the United States, Watani, my homeland, which is Syrian and German, and finally, The White Helmets, which is a Syrian documentary. So the first documentary I'm going to detail for you is Extremis, which might not sound like an American film, but it is. And it is a film that is actually, that takes place, or, and remember, it is a documentary, so it was shot live. And it's a short documentary film that follows the doctors, families, and patients as they make end-of-life decisions. So this movie is one that actually takes place in a hospice ward. All the patients that are in this movie are basically hooked to a life support machine, and it details the very difficult decision that the doctors as well as the families of the patients have to make in terms of the people who are on the life support machine, can't live without it, and whether or not it's worth it at the end of the day to unplug them from life support. Inevitably, the people who are unplugged from life support will die, but that doesn't mean it's not, it's an easy decision. In fact, in almost every case, it isn't. So the movie is very good at showing you the difficult decisions that the doctors have to go through. And it's not even easy for doctors to gradually take somebody's life this way. So if you want to see Extremis, you can either check out the cluster of documentary shorts that are in select theaters right now, or you can actually go on Netflix and view it for yourself. The next documentary I'm going to review for you, and by the way, before I get to the next documentary, I just want to tell you that usually I give my ratings of, you know, knock out if a movie's great, check out if a movie is okay but worth watching, strike out if it's not worth watching, and flunk out if it's absolutely terrible. This time I won't do it because it goes without saying that all five of these documentaries are great. So just to give you a disclaimer, no ratings this time. I'm just going to give you a rundown of these movies, and I'm going to tell you exactly what I think about them. So the next movie I'm going to review for you is 4.1 Miles, and I'll give you a synopsis of it. So 4.1 Miles is a short documentary about a Coast Guard captain on a remote Greek island who is charged with saving thousands of migrants crossing the Aegean Sea during the European migrant crisis. So these refugees, who are coming from Syria, I believe, or some war-torn country, it may even be Turkey, I don't know, or it may vary. But either way, they have to travel 4.1 miles, which doesn't seem like a very long distance, and by car it isn't, but they have to go by boat. And there are, I won't say hundreds, but there are definitely a good number of refugees who come to this Greek island seeking refuge, understandably, and they are lucky enough to be rescued by this Greek Coast Guard captain who does this out of the goodness of his own heart. So it's very noble that somebody would do this, but that doesn't mean that this captain, this Coast Guard captain, doesn't go through his own hardships. In fact, it's really hard to watch some parts of this documentary, especially when you see that the refugees are kind of rescued from the boat, but some of them don't make it all the way to the Greek island through the Aegean Sea. And it's really harrowing to watch some of this documentary go on, but it's also important to note, especially given the controversial subject that is immigration. The next documentary is Joe's Violin, which is a U.S. film, and it's shot in New York City, and it's about a Polish Holocaust survivor who is still alive, and he's in his 90s, but he has a 70-year-old violin, which he donated out of the goodness of his own heart to a local instrument drive, and the new owner is a 12-year-old girl from the Bronx. And it's a really moving film, which actually put tears in my eyes when I was watching it. It was amazing to hear about how this Holocaust survivor obtained this violin, how he learned to play the violin, and also it was really nice to see the 12-year-old girl not only get the violin and appreciate it, but also when she met with the Holocaust survivor. It's a really moving film. The next documentary is Watani, My Homeland. And this is a documentary that details Syrian refugees going from war-torn Syria into a new life in small-town Germany. And it's a movie that, again, makes you really appreciate the struggles that some refugees go through, even when they go to a place where they're not necessarily welcome. And speaking of Syria, the final film, which I highly recommend, which is also available on Netflix, is The White Helmets. Before I saw this documentary, I saw a story about them on 60 Minutes, and it's a totally volunteer rescue squad in Syria that actually pulls people out of buildings that have been bombed by either the Syrians or the Russians. In other words, it shows the casualty of war that these good-hearted people who wear the white helmets volunteer to not let happen. It's a really good documentary.
Alvin and the Chipmunks want to remind you.
To Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you're either listening on Boston Free Radio, watching and listening on SCAT-V, or watching and listening on Facebook Live. Two channels. So, as I told you before, I was reviewing the documentary shorts. All of them are great. If I had to pick one winner, and I really hate to pick, it's almost like choosing a child or choosing a favorite child, but it would have to be Joe's Violin. And I'm guessing that actually The White Helmets will win for Best Documentary, but the reason I chose Joe's Violin was not only because I saw it and I was moved literally to tears by it, but also The White Helmets, Watani, My Homeland, and Extremis are all and 4.1 Miles, not Extremis, are movies that deal with the refugee crisis. And usually the way Oscar nominations work is three movies that are about sort of the same thing, neither of those movies actually win. So I'm just keeping that in mind. But in spite of that, Joe's Violin was the one that I really appreciated the most. I thought by a very narrow margin, it was the best. So with that said, let's get into my next topic, live action shorts. So the nominees are Ennemis Intérieurs, La Femme et la TGV, Silent Nights, Sing, also known as Mindenki, and Time Code. So the first movie, Ennemis Intérieurs, it's a short movie. It's only about 30 minutes long. It's actually 27 minutes to be exact. But it's a movie that will probably draw comparisons to My Dinner with Andre in the sense that it's two people talking. And actually, it's a movie that takes place in the 90s, not today, although there's actually a certain timelessness of it that could take place today. And it takes place actually in France, where the French government has a problem with Algerian terrorism. So there are two men, one who is a person who works with the French Immigration Service, who's also a person of color, by the way, and that plays into the narrative, as you'll eventually see, and one who is an Algerian who was actually born in Algeria and raised in France. So it's a fascinating movie about two men of different backgrounds who are, well, actually determining whether or not the Algerian refugee is a terrorist. The second movie is La Femme et le TGV, which is also The Woman and the TGV, which is a train. And it's a love story, and it's about a lonely woman who lives next to a train track, and also a friendship she strikes up with the TGV train driver, who eventually every time he goes by her house by train, either in the morning or in the evening, he throws a note at her house. And the train is going at 185 miles an hour, so it's a little unrealistic that somebody who throws a piece of paper out of a train will have it actually go near her house, but it's a sweet love story, and it's one that definitely entraps you once you actually see it. The next movie is Silent Nights, which is actually a film that takes place in Norway. And it's about a volunteer at a housing shelter who falls for a refugee from Ghana, who's a man. And I got to tell you, the actor who plays the Ghanaian refugee is a dead ringer for David Ortiz. I'm just saying that. But a lot of subjects play into this movie. It is very much like La Femme et le TGV. It's a movie that's a sweet love story, but it also has some interesting twists, and it also touches upon subjects such as immigration, interracial relationships, and also honesty in a lot of instances, and integrity. It's certainly a film worth watching, and as you could probably guess, the movie is called Silent Nights. And it does take place around Christmas time. Not entirely around Christmas time, but that is one of the themes of the movie, but that's not at all why I enjoyed it. The next movie is a movie called Sing. And no, it's not the animated movie. It's actually a film that is from Hungary. And the actual title of the movie is Mindenke, which is Hungarian for Sing. And it's a childhood drama with a lot of music. It takes place in 1990s Budapest, and it's actually inspired by a true story. And it follows an award-winning school choir and the new girl in class who just might uncover the ugly secret behind their choir's fame. So I don't want to give too much away, not only because I don't have time, but also because this is a movie you have to see for yourself. It's a movie with a lot of round characters, and there are certain characters in the movie who you're not entirely sure what their motives are, but it's a good coming-of-age film about friendship, and the girls in the movie seem to be pushing 13. They're definitely young girls, and it ended in a very unpredictable way, and one actually I really liked. And finally, the last movie is Time Code. Time Code is a movie that takes place in Spain, and it's about two security guards named Luna and Diego who are securing a parking lot. And Diego does the night shift and Luna works by day, so they only really talk to each other in passing as they switch shifts, and they must work long shifts because they see each other at the very beginning and the very end of the day. But they have a certain connection by way of these cameras, and it's actually another sweet love story. So if I were to choose best documentary live action short, or excuse me, best short live action movie of the five, my pick would be Silent Nights, because I think that's the film that stayed with me the most. Again, it's by a very narrow margin. I'm a little apologetic because of that, but if you see these excellent short films, you'll really appreciate what people outside the Hollywood system will make for short features, especially outside of the United States. And I had the most appreciation for Silent Nights, I think because it raised a lot of interesting questions about the subjects I told you about. Immigration, interracial relationships, integrity, and I think that's the one that's going to win, at least that's in my opinion. Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. The next subject I'm going to tackle is the Oscar nominations for, or the Oscar nominees for, Best Short Animated Feature. In other words, Best Animated Film Short Subject. So the five nominations are Blind Vaisha from Canada, Borrowed Time from the United States, Pearl Cider and Cigarettes from Canada, Pearl from the United States, and finally, Piper from the United States. So, not a lot of foreign movies here, at least not outside of North America, but that doesn't mean they're not all intriguing. In fact, all of them are. So, let's start with Blind Vaisha. Blind Vaisha is an interestingly animated short subject. I'm not sure exactly what the animation style is, but there's definitely some elements of hand-drawn animation, but either way, it's beautifully animated. And this is a short subject about a woman who, from the moment she was born, this woman, Vaisha, was a very special girl. And she couldn't see particularly well, or at least not the present. The deal with her is that with her left eye, she could see the past, and with her right eye, she could see the future, but she could not see the present. So as a result of that, even though she's not technically blind, the villagers in this story refer to her as Blind Vaisha. It's a fascinating fable, and certainly one that is told, it's a great story that's told really well. Borrowed Time is the next short I'll be reviewing for you. And this is a short that is actually made by Pixar animators, but was not distributed under Pixar. But still, Borrowed Time is about a weathered sheriff who returns to the remains of an accident he has spent a lifetime trying to forget. And with each step forward, the memories come flooding back. Faced with a mistake once again, he must find the strength to carry on. This is a movie that is not only extremely well animated, but it's also darker than anything that Pixar has released under the Disney Pixar name. And it's one that is surprising, it's shocking, and without spoiling very much, it is actually a little sad. But it's a movie that will undoubtedly stay with you. The next movie I'm going to summarize is Pearl Cider and Cigarettes. This is the longest of the animation shorts, and it is at 35 minutes. The other four are between 5 and 15 minutes. So this is a brutally honest story of Robert's turbulent relationship with a self-destructive yet charismatic friend from childhood who cries out for help from a military hospital in China and sets Rob on a wild ride to get him home to Vancouver. So I gotta be honest, of the five animated features, this is the only one I have not seen. So I can't comment on it yet, but I do have some good news. Very much like other short subjects, you can catch this one either in the cluster of animated shorts that are in select theaters right now. Check your local listings. Or you can actually check this, or you can see this in its entirety on the video website Vimeo. Although it will cost you money. It'll cost you $5 to see it. But it's one I'll definitely check out very soon, and I hope you will too. The next film I'm going to summarize is Pearl. Now, Pearl is an animated movie that's actually very similar to ones to shorts that Disney has come out with, and it's actually kind of surprising that Disney did not release this one. But the director of this one is Patrick Osborne, and this is a movie that's set inside a home, which is actually a hatchback. It's a car. And Pearl follows a girl and her dad as they crisscross the country chasing their dreams. It's a story about the gifts we hand down and their power. So this is another movie that packs an emotional punch. It's a computer animated film, and it really does a good job at telling a story, but you're only told the story through the inside of this hatchback. And this is a movie that you can actually see on YouTube for free if you wish, but a disclaimer about the YouTube version, it's not that it's edited, but there's this 360 viewing you can do when you see it on YouTube, which is kind of cool, but it sort of distracts you from the story, because if you choose to see the movie at a certain angle, you might miss out on other things that are going on around here. So if to get the full experience, I recommend actually seeing the movie not on YouTube. And you can catch it in that cluster of Oscar shorts that are released by the cable channel Shorts HD. And I recommend you see it that way. But either way you see it, you're going to be impressed by the animation, and you're going to be very impressed by the story. And the last animated short that has been nominated is one you probably have seen, especially if you've seen the movie Finding Dory, and that movie is Piper. This is a very short computer animated movie from Pixar, Disney Pixar that is, and it's only 6 minutes long, but it's about a mother bird trying to teach her little one how to find food by herself. In the process, she encounters a traumatic experience that she must overcome in order to survive. So the animation on this one is nearly perfect. If I did not know that this was going to be released by Disney Pixar, I would have guessed, at least for the first 3 minutes, that somebody was actually filming real birds. So it tells a really good story. It's a sweet story, but the animation is incredible. So, of these five short animated films, which one do I think should win? That one would be, drumroll please, Borrowed Time. Because I think it tells an original story. I mean, it does tell an original story. I don't just think that. But in addition to that, it also tells a story that really resonates. And it resonates without any of the characters speaking a single word. Also, upon researching this film, I really appreciated what the filmmakers had to go through to make this movie. This is a movie that's only 7 minutes long, but it actually took 5 years to make. Because remember, the animators worked for Pixar, but they did this on the side in nights and weekends. And in spite of how good the movie is, you have to respect that effort.
WWE superstar Alberto.
Free radio. movie critic Dan Burke. Words on Film is the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures, to which you are listening on bostonfreeradio.com or watching on SCATV Live, remember, or watching on Facebook Live, either on my personal channel or on Boston Free Radio's Facebook page. But either way you join me, I'm glad you could join me. So now that I've given you my synopsis of my picks for best documentary short subject, best animated short subject, and best live action short film, I'm now going to give you my nominees for all the other categories. Now, this is based solely on if I pick the winners. And I'm also going to give you a little bit of rationale of why I think this movie will win or should win for their respective rewards. Also, another disclaimer, I'm not giving you every category. In fact, regretfully, I've had to leave out a lot of sciences due to time. But, and even though I've been pretty good at picking those, I'm just going to give you a lot of the arts categories. So I'm going to start with Best Original Screenplay. The nominees are Hell or High Water, La La Land, The Lobster, Manchester by the Sea, and 20th Century Women. The movie that I think should win Best Original Screenplay and the movie that I think will win is La La Land. And it's not only because I absolutely enjoyed the movie. I also think it was a really original story. It wasn't afraid to embrace the escapism of movie musicals, as well as getting grounded in some reality, which made the movie a little bit more poignant. I also liked the way the movie ended, and I think that this is a movie that's deserving of Best Original Screenplay. A potential upset would be Manchester by the Sea, but my bets are on La La Land. Best Adapted Screenplay. In other words, best screenplays that are based on material from another medium. The nominees are Arrival, Fences, Hidden Figures, Lion, and Moonlight. What I think should be Best Adapted Screenplay is Moonlight. The reason I chose Moonlight is because not only did it tell a compelling story, but it also almost reinvented the three-act structure. I don't think I've seen another movie that has created a whole life out of a three-act structure. Of course, there was Boyhood, but that wasn't a three-act structure. That was more a 12-act structure, which I commend it for doing, of course. But Moonlight certainly had my sympathies for the characters, as well as some fears about other characters. But it's a movie that certainly hooked me, and I thought it told a compelling story, not to mention had an original way of telling that story. A potential upset would be Fences, which is based on the play of the same name by August Wilson. But again, that play was also adapted very well, but my bets are on Moonlight. My next category is, well, I'll just give you, I already gave you the nominees, but I'll just say the short films. Animated, my pick is Borrowed Time. Live action short films, my pick is Silent Nights. And short film documentary, my pick is Joe's Violin. So now on to the best original song from a movie. The nominees are Audition, The Fools Who Dream from La La Land, music by Justin Hurwitz, lyrics by Benj Pasek and Justin Paul. Can't Stop the Feeling from Trolls, music and lyrics by Justin Timberlake, Max Martin, and Carl Johan Schuster. City of Stars from La La Land, music by Justin Hurwitz, lyric by Benj Pasek and Justin Paul. The Empty Chair from Jim, the James Foley story, music and lyrics by J. Ralph and Sting. And finally, How Far I'll Go from Moana, music and lyrics by Lin-Manuel Miranda. My choice for Best Original Song is Audition, The Fools Who Dream. The reason I chose that song is because it's the song I probably best remember from La La Land. In addition to that, Emma Stone sung her heart out on that song, and it also had great lyrics. So it had a lot going for it. Of course, I don't think of it as going for the more dramatic song, but it, of the five songs on this list, it's the song that stuck with me the most. On to the next category, Best Original Score. The nominees are Jackie, La La Land, Lion, Moonlight, and Passengers. My choice for Best Original Score, music, La La Land. I think the reason is because maybe I would have chosen Moonlight, but the parts of Moonlight that stayed with me the most were when there were songs that were previously used before. Like the song Hello Stranger, for instance, broke my heart when I heard it in Moonlight. But the point is that the original music in La La Land, not just the musical numbers where people sang, stuck with me a lot more than the other four films. And I think that's the one that's going to win. Moonlight might pull a potential upset. Lion might even pull an even bigger upset, but my bets are on La La Land. Now on to Best Documentary Feature. In other words, this is the full-length documentary category. The nominees are Fire at Sea, I Am Not Your Negro, Life Animated, OJ Made in America, and 13th. Disclaimer in this category, I have not seen, as of the date of the show, Fire at Sea or OJ Made in America. However, my bets are on a movie I have seen, which I have not reviewed for the show yet, but I will, and that movie is 13th, which is directed by Ava DuVernay. This is a movie, if you haven't seen it, go on Netflix and check it out. This is a movie that really makes you think about the prison system in our country, and there are some very shocking facts. Michael Moore introduced the shock and the corruption of the prison system in his movie Where to Invade Next, but Ava DuVernay elaborates upon it a lot more and how it's been institutionalized, or rather made to work against African Americans and, for that matter, many people of color. It's a fascinating documentary. It's the one that stuck with me the most, and my bets are on 13th, and especially after the Oscar So White controversy last year, I think this one's going to win.
Why is my son having trouble?
Words on Film on Boston Free Radio, the spoken word show dedicated to moving pictures. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke, and this is the special Before the Oscar show. I should have given it an official name, but I'll work on that next year. So anyway, I've given you my picks for best, or who I think should win in addition to who I think will win. I'm making a lot of risky bets here, but I covered Best Original Screenplay, Best Adapted Screenplay, Best Short Film Animated, Best Short Film Live Action, Best Short Film Documentary, Best Feature Length Documentary, Best Original Song, and Best Original Score. Now I'm going to get into the Best Animated Feature. For Best Animated Feature, the nominees are Kubo and the Two Strings, Moana, My Life as a Zucchini, The Red Turtle, and finally, Zootopia. So, another disclaimer, of the movies that are nominated for Best Animated Feature, I have not seen either My Life as a Zucchini or The Red Turtle. But I'd be willing to bet that the winner for Best Animated Feature will be Kubo and the Two Strings, or at least that's what I think should win. The reason for that is, unfortunately, Kubo and the Two Strings was not a hit, but the word of mouth after it left theaters has been really strong. In addition to that, while it was troubling that there were not a lot of voice actors who were Asian American, or at least not Asian, or at least not in the lead roles, I still love the animation. I love the original story. In fact, this could have been a shoe-in for best original screenplay, because I don't think it was based on another medium. But overall, I thought it was certainly a movie that was outside the box. And this might be an upset, because the winner might be Zootopia, but I don't think it should be. I think it should be Kubo and the Two Strings, and that's what I'm hedging my bets on. So now on to the acting categories. For Best Actress in a Supporting Role, the nominees are Viola Davis, Fences; Naomi Harris, Moonlight; Nicole Kidman, Lion; Octavia Spencer, Hidden Figures; and finally, Michelle Williams, Manchester by the Sea. The winner, who I think should be the winner for this category, is Viola Davis for Fences. The reason is that I think she's long overdue for an Academy Award win. I think she should have won years ago when she was up against Meryl Streep for The Iron Lady. And Meryl Streep won. This was one of the only times where I think Meryl Streep should not have won. But in addition to that, Viola Davis gives a heart-wrenching performance in Fences that stayed with me probably more than the other four actresses. In fact, I don't think Nicole Kidman should have been nominated for this category at all, but I won't get into my grievances about who should and who shouldn't have been nominated, at least not for this show. Now on to the category Best Actor in a Supporting Role. The nominees are Mahershala Ali, Moonlight; Jeff Bridges, Hell or High Water; Lucas Hedges, Manchester by the Sea; Dev Patel, Lion; and finally, Michael Shannon, Nocturnal Animals. The person who I think should be the winner, and who I'm betting will be the winner, is Mahershala Ali for Moonlight. The reason being is because Mr. Ali was only in Moonlight for one third of it, but he had the greatest impact on the lead character in the movie. And you could see it in certainly subtle ways in the next two thirds of the movie. In addition to that, he plays a very charismatic and likable character who becomes a father figure to a child who, ironically, he's also, without realizing it, killing his mother because he's a drug dealer. I think it was a very complex performance, and he certainly had the biggest impact on me. So now on to Best Actress in a Leading Role. The nominees are Isabel Huppert for Elle; Ruth Negga, Loving; Natalie Portman, Jackie; Emma Stone, La La Land; and finally, Meryl Streep, Florence Foster Jenkins. The winner who I think should win is Emma Stone for La La Land. I think she gave a really good performance, very heartfelt in a lot of areas, very fun in others, especially the up-tempo musical numbers. And I think she's certainly, of the four actresses who are nominated here, the one that stood out to me the most. I will give a disclaimer. I did not see Isabel Huppert in Elle, but the reason I think Emma Stone will win is because the Academy has a habit of giving the award to the younger actress, not the youngest per se, but the younger actress who is kind of coming in on her own. And I do think that Emma Stone is overdue for a win, and I think she deserved to be nominated for this role. I think she'll win. For Best Actor, the nominees are Casey Affleck, Manchester by the Sea; Andrew Garfield, Hacksaw Ridge; Ryan Gosling, La La Land; Viggo Mortensen, Captain Fantastic; and Denzel Washington for Fences. Now, this one was really difficult for me, probably more difficult than the other three acting categories. Who I think should be the winner? Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea. I think Casey Affleck has a very subdued performance in this movie. However, it's one that actually packs a very big emotional punch. And it's one that also, I hate to be repetitive here, but it did stay with me. If I were to choose somebody who was more of an upset, I would probably say Denzel Washington for Fences, because I also think he did a great job in his role as well. But Casey Affleck is my choice. Now on to Best Director. The Best Directing categories in terms of movies are as follows. Arrival, Hacksaw Ridge, La La Land, Manchester by the Sea, and Moonlight. Who I think should win is Damien Chazelle for La La Land. The reason being is that not only was La La Land a great movie, but there was also some really great continuing tracking shots, especially from the opening musical number. I don't remember the name of that musical number, but it took place in LA traffic. That was a very hard shot to make, let alone for somebody who's only directing his second feature film. So for that reason and others, my choice is Damien Chazelle for La La Land. I hope he gets it. My bets are he will. To Words on Film on Boston Free Radio. I'm your host and movie critic, Dan Burke, and I'm not yet done with the Oscar nominations yet. I was planning to be, but I might as well save the best for last, which is what I'm doing. And then when I give you my pick for Best Picture, or what I think will win Best Picture, in addition to what I think should win, I'll go on to my next segment, which is what's coming out next. This is the movies that are coming out on Oscar weekend, which I will probably check out. So, for Best Picture at the Oscars, the nominees are, in alphabetical order, Arrival, Fences, Hacksaw Ridge, Hell or High Water, Hidden Figures, La La Land, Lion, Manchester by the Sea, and Moonlight. So in my opinion, this award comes down to two films, La La Land and Moonlight. Both are great in their own way, but I'm going to have to go with my pick for Best Picture. I'm putting my bets on it. Best Picture, Moonlight. Because as I said, it had a great screenplay. It had fantastic actors in it, including many who weren't even nominated. Not just Naomi Harris and Mahershala Ali, but all three actors who played the child in the movie. I forget the character's name, but in any event, it really was a great movie. It's one that stayed with me emotionally. It could be Moonlight, it could be La La Land, I don't know, but I'm betting on Moonlight because that, I think, is the best picture of the year, and it's what I think should win. So, those are my picks for the Oscar nominees. Do you disagree with them? Do you agree with them? For those of you who are listening and watching me on Facebook, leave a comment. I'd like to know what you think. But now I'm going to get into a segment which is shortened for time, which is what's coming out next. These are movies that are coming out this coming weekend. And we have some interesting ones for Oscar weekend. One of them is a movie called Get Out, which is not only amazing because of its cast, but of who directs the movie. So this is a movie that is a comedy, horror, mystery, thriller. I don't exactly see the comedy in the premise, but here's the premise for you. A young African-American man visits his Caucasian girlfriend's mysterious family estate. And the director of this movie is actually Jordan Peele of the comedy duo Key and Peele. So for him to make his directorial debut with a drama is unusual, but not unwelcome. The stars of this movie include a relative newcomer, from what I know, Daniel Kaluuya, and also stars Allison Williams of the show Girls, who's also Brian Williams' daughter, Bradley Whitford, and Catherine Keener. It looks like a very interesting movie. Don't know if it's going to be out in theaters near me, but if it is, I will check it out, and I'll let you know exactly what I think. Another movie that's coming out in theaters is Collide. Collide is a movie about an American backpacker who gets involved with a ring of drug smugglers as their driver, though he winds up on the run from his employers across Cologne high-speed autobahn. And Cologne, by the way, is not a city in France. It's in Germany. And, of course, the autobahn is the famous highway that has no speed limit. So the stars of this movie include Nicholas Holt, Felicity Jones, Anthony Hopkins, and Ben Kingsley. Looks like a great cast. Looks like a fun action movie. I'll check it out if it's in theaters, and I'll let you know exactly what I think. Another movie that's coming out in theaters is an animated movie called Rock Dog. And this is a movie about a literal dog who, when a radio falls from the sky into the hands of this wide-eyed pup, he leaves home to fulfill his dream of becoming a musician, setting into motion a series of completely unexpected events. So this animated movie, which is not released from Disney, Pixar, or DreamWorks, or any major studios I know of, I don't even think Illumination Studios is releasing this one, but it features the voice talents of, amongst other people, Luke Wilson, Eddie Izzard, J.K. Simmons, and Lewis Black. So a really good cast right there, voice cast. And it's actually animated by former Pixar storyboard artist and Toy Story 2 co-director Ash Brennan. So it's interesting to see Disney animators separating from Disney and doing their own thing. Of course, from seeing the poster of this movie, I didn't really suspect too much about it, but maybe it'll tell a really good story. I hope it does. It's great to see, as I said, not that there's anything wrong with Disney, but it's great to see animators leave Disney and do their own thing. It's amazing to see people who succeed in making their own films, like Don Bluth or Tim Burton, who didn't direct many animated films after leaving Disney, but he directed some, and they were really good.